Right, let's start our lecture. Today we are going to deal with operating systems. So just give an introduction of operating systems, their general characteristics and how they developed up to where we are today. So that is basically what we are going to deal with in the first part of our lecture. I think we have to do another lecture maybe after two, where we'll look at the general characteristics of operating systems, because after this we've gone into the slot for another lecture. So we'll just do the first part, then after lunch we'll go to the next part. Right. So when we talk about the operating system, we look at how it developed and its uses so that we can have a better view and understanding of the functionality of these operating systems. Right. So when people talk about operating systems, some just use the word OS. It's just a short form of operating systems. So if someone says the OS, he's talking about the operating system. So in general, we can say an operating system is a program acting as an interface between the user and the computer hardware. So we are saying between the computer hardware and the user, the interface between those two is the operating system. So that's what we can say in general about operating systems. So what does the operating system do? It will interface by providing a user-friendly environment, which the user can use to either develop, execute, or run programs. So if there was no operating system, it means someone would have to know the hardware programming for the computer so that you could use a computer. But because of the operating system, you actually don't need to know what is happening behind the scenes. That means it gives you a black box view of your computer system. So we can say that the operating system will hide the hardware complexities from the user who is not interested in the hardware complexities. So in order to achieve this purpose, the operating system uses some of these resources so that it can perform its tasks, that it uses memory, it uses the processor, input, output, file systems, and other things so that whatever I want to use the computer for, it can provide us with the solution. So in other words, we are saying the user who uses a mouse, uses a modem, a keyboard, who use the CD-ROM drive, laser printers, and the monitor, but he doesn't have to know what happens if he clicks a mouse. All he has to know is, if I click a mouse, I should be doing this type of control. So whatever type of electric signal passes from the mouse until it comes to the screen is hidden from the user by the operating system. So you realize that it is very important to have the operating systems. Also, the operating system will be there to manage the resources of the computer systems. That means it also will give resources to certain programs and users according to its own inbuilt program. Remember, we said an operating system is a program. In other words, someone had to sit down and write that program so that it could work as the operating system. So the programmer will not have to take consideration of the hardware when he is writing his program. He doesn't have to know how long it takes for this hardware to respond. The operating system will do that. So these are some of the services that you get from the operating system. One, it does process management so that the processor will work under the guidance of the operating system, memory management and firmware management, device management, which is specifically hardware management, and concurrent control of running programs that is done by the operating system, right? So how does the operating system work? It uses some predefined libraries for hardware and software interaction, right? So it means you have to install the operating system on your machine first. Then after that, any other predefined library will be installed in the operating system will use it to communicate with the different devices. So if you look at the diagram, this diagram, you realize that at the lowest level, we have the hardware, which is our physical components. Then we have what is called the machine language, which is understood by the machine, right? Then from there, you have the operating system. So the operating system now will be linking between the system programs and the machine language. That means there's a conversion from a system program to a machine language and from a machine language to a system program that is done by the operating system. Then we go to the application programs, which the users will be using. So the user uses the application programs. And so you realize that he doesn't have to know what is happening behind the scenes. All he has to do is know the programming language, write his program and execute it. The rest is done by the operating system. Let's take, for example, if you write a program to say C is got A plus B, then there is a written program which will allow you to just say C is got A plus B, then you get the answer. You say C is equal to, you get the answer of A plus B. But if there was no operating system, that means you have to know the language that the microprocessor of that machine uses. So this will be your machine code. So you have to write all these in order to just add two numbers. But with the operating system, you just said A is equal to B plus C. And this whole thing is done by the operating system. So you don't have to know how it does the loading of accumulators, adding A and B and the like, and the storage. That is why we say the operating system will also hide the complexities from the user. You also don't have to know which memory location will load the value 80, which one will load the value 81, and so on. Where will the solution come into? You don't have to know about that. The operating system will take care of that. So in an operating system installed machine with an intermediate layer, then our programs obtain some advantage of mobility by not dealing with the hardware. So what we are saying is, if you have an HP machine and someone has a Mac or an Apple machine or the like, you can still take a program, let's say Microsoft Word, you write a file on HP machine, then you take it to your Mac or anywhere else, still you'll be able to read and edit your file. Why? Because the intermediary section is offered by the operating system. Otherwise, there wouldn't be mobility of programs from one machine to another. So now in essence, we are saying C is called A plus B. In an 8086 based machine, this program would not run because the 8086 uses its own syntax. But because of the operating system, it will take care of those processor specific requirements. And then you run your program so easily. So in other words, the user will write a simple program with no hardware consideration. Then the operating system will convert it into a sophisticated program which considers the hardware characteristics of the machine. Then that new program is the machine language which will now drive the hardware, and the hardware will start to respond. So you can see that all you have to know is to how to write this program. Then after that, the operating system takes care of that, and programming becomes very easy. The use of the machine also becomes very easy. So the operating system now gives you an advantage, right? In the hardware, and the operating system will give you an extended or a virtual machine. That means the machine that you see when you are using your computer is different from the actual hardware wiring of your machine. All thanks to the presence of the operating system. So on that side, the real machine, which will be doing your work, running your programs and the like, uses machine language and in the hardware. But because of the operating system, you now have a virtual machine where you think you are writing programs in a certain language, but in fact, the operating system, we have to take care of the hardware requirements of the physical machine. So that's why we are saying it gives you a virtual machine. So what you see is not present in hardware, right? That's the advantage that we get from there. But then we know that the operating system is a program, but it is priority over other programs. That means it has the ability to operate in kernel mode. That means when it deals with the microprocessor, and also in user mode, when it's now taking care of the needs of the user. So that's the work of the operating system. So the difference now between the kernel mode and the user mode is that in the kernel mode, instructions, which are hardware specific or machine language instructions, they are only valid in the kernel mode. Then when you go to the user mode, some of the instructions will not be valid. So that's the main difference between the kernel mode, which is specific to the microprocessor and the hardware, and the user mode, which also takes care of the requirements of the user. So we talked about the history of computers, and you know we started with the ENIAC when the hardware was hardwired and the operating system was also made and loaded using switches and punched cards and the like. And I think we talked about that, the ENIAC in our history of computer systems. And you can see that it was using vacuum tubes, which were bigger. That's why it was bigger and consuming more power. And on the back, someone was supposed to be there to change the switches so that the programs that are being loaded could work in the machine. So the programs were loaded manually using switches, punched cards, or paper tapes. I think we talked about that. So that's an example of a punched card, which we said was used initially. Then they developed into machines which developed the punching cards, and then the paper tapes that were being loaded there. And then all that made the operating system. But today we have a different scenario where the operating system is written as a software program, which then communicates with hardware. So you realize that all these other things became irrelevant, right? Right, all other things became irrelevant. You could develop now your software programs in terms of libraries and written programs that you could develop, right? So that's how the operating system came until there was the advent of multi-programming, where you could share resources between more than one process. And that is where our operating system becomes very, very useful, right? In other words, when a process is waiting, say for input, then the other process can use the CPU, and you realize that it also enabled maximum CPU utilization, right? That is the advantage that we get with the use of our operating systems, right? So you can also have more than one user on a terminal, right? And they can execute computers programs just like that. So like here, you see that there's the main computer, which is a CPU and executing processes by utilizing of the operating systems. Then you connect terminals, the main computer, which are used for input and output, and they don't do any processing. They do not have CPUs. So you can look up at this, like the use of tools, where there is a main computer system, and this one will just be using all those processors stored in the main computer systems. We call them terminals, right? Then there's also a multiprocessor system that is more than one processor, which will be sharing peripherals and the like. I'm sure these days we have the dual core and the like. Those are the multiprocessor systems, and they have greater computing power and higher reliabilities, right? So the microprocessor systems, you can have tightly coupled or loosely coupled systems. In a tightly coupled system, the processor is assigned specific duties, but the processors work in close association. There's possible sharing of the same memory. In loosely coupled, each processor is its own memory and a copy of the operating system. Then the issue of networks. Then in the network system, each process runs its own machine, but the operating system access the other machine, right? So this will enable file sharing, messaging, etc. Right? So in a network, like now, we are all connected and we are networking, we are communicating. That is also the use of network operating systems, right? So in a network, the computer, each computer system is resources. That means even when the network is down, it can still do some of its own functions. But then when the network is up, it can also share some resources with other networks, right? Then the distributed systems are just similar to networks. However, there's no need to exchange information. It is handled by the operating system itself whenever it is necessary to share information. So you realize that from there, we have different architectures of computers, and we are going to do that in computer architecture and operating systems in a more detailed manner. So that is the end of our introduction for our operating systems. Like I said, I have another lecture coming around 12. So I will notify you, I think, around 2, so that we pick from here to do the second part of our lecture. So we end here. If you have questions, you can write them down, then we'll deal with them in the next.